give you more space, maybe.
E poi quando per il collegamento, cioè per qua, poi fate voi.
Ci pensate, mi serve subito?
Sì, sì, partiamo subito con, cioè, con quello. Sì, sì. Okay, so maybe we can start. Yeah, okay. So hi all, thank you for being here. I'm Carola Frediani, a journalist at La Stampa, and I'm pleased to be here to introduce this interesting panel with Stefania Maurizi, who is a colleague from journalist from La Repubblica and also a media partner with Wikileaks since 2009. Then we have Lorenzo Franceschi-Bicchierai, a security reporter at Motherboard Vice in the US, covering hacking and cybersecurity and leaks. And Andrei Soldatov, sorry, director of Agentura and investigative reporter, expert on Russian security services, and also co-author of the book The Red Web. So it's a very dense panel because I just want to show some of the timeline of the things we are going to talk. Because if you followed the news since last summer and the U.S. presidential campaign, you will know there's been a lot of unexpected things going on, and all mixing together in a quite confusing way, also for a journalist. So I listed some of the main events, not all, not at all, that just to help you to have an overview of the complexity of the media landscape, referring to some of the facts we are going to talk. So, you know, we had like the so-called DNC hack, the hacking of the Democratic National Committee in the US, and then we had the leak of a lot of emails that some of them ended up on WikiLeaks, and then we had an FBI investigation, we had some very strong position by the U.S. government, who at the end basically claimed that, you know, Russia was behind it. And also we had also other stories about, alleged possible connection between Trump associates and Russia, and also an investigation on this. Of course, if we go like this, no, okay, no, it doesn't matter. Yeah, anyway, if we go, maybe we can do this, yeah. Anyway, some Russian hackers.
Russian hackers.
They are here.
Thanks.
So, how many stories are here? You know, in this timeline we just saw. There are different stories, of course. There is a story of the hack, who did it and how. There is a story of the leaks on WikiLeaks and elsewhere, and the contents of the leaks. There is the story of all the political consequences of what happened, and the story of US and Russia relations, and also also the story within the US government and possible tensions between Trump or Trump administration and intelligence agencies, and also what's going on in Russia, actually, which for journalists living, you know, in Western countries, sometimes I was telling before to Andrei, it's very difficult to understand now what's going on. So let's start from the beginning. So from the hack, okay, the hacking of the Democratic National Committee and what happened also afterwards. And so I would start with Lorenzo, because you followed very closely both the hack, the leaking, and also you also were able to engage in chat with this online persona that at a certain point, you know, like came out of the blue, saying, claiming that he was the one who did the hack, right? And that he was a Romanian hacker, but a lone hacker, right? And it was a very interesting story because, Lorenzo, I think you were the only one who actually were able to engage him and make him talk via chat, right? So maybe you can tell a little bit both of this story and also about, you know, the hack and...
Yeah. Hi, everyone. This is like June 15 or 14 last year, and the Washington Post reports that two groups of Russian hackers broke into the DNC, which is basically the Democratic Party, over the last few months, or even a year, actually. And they went undetected for a few months, stole all kinds of documents and emails until they got caught and got expelled, basically. That was a big story at the time. This was still, you know, a few months from the election, but basically the story was Russia was spying on the Democratic Party and to try to find out what they thought about Donald Trump. So even Russia was a little confused about Donald Trump. This company, American company called CrowdStrike, which was hired to investigate the hack, comes out and says this was Russia, this was two groups, they call them Fancy Bear and Cozy Bear. But they also said that these are actually just spies. So they're the FSB and the GRU, which is the military intelligence in Russia. But then after like a couple of, I think 24 hours more or less, this character calling himself Guccifer II, which is, he takes the name from another famous, a relatively famous hacker. You might remember him because he was the hacker that stole the paintings of George W. Bush and inadvertently launched George W. Bush's new artistic career, which is a very bizarre outcome for Bush. Anyway, so he says CrowdStrike is wrong. He doesn't say I'm not Russian, but basically that's the implication. He says CrowdStrike was wrong. I'm just a lone hacker. It was just me. I want to like denounce the Illuminati, this conspiracy theory. And to prove that he was really him, he does publish documents that come from the DNC. So at that point, it's not just someone that says, oh, it's me, because this happens all the time. When there's a cyber attack, hackers come out and say, oh, I did it, because they want to be famous. But in this case, it does look like it was him. But as Carola said, I tried to talk to him because he had a Twitter account, just like everyone else. And he had open DMs, so direct messages. So I just sent him a message, and I thought it was not going to answer, because at that point I suspected that it was Russian, because a lot of people were already saying, this seems too good to be true, it happened too quickly, his claims are too weird, it just doesn't make sense. So I thought he wouldn't answer, because he didn't have any interest to answer. But I was wrong, he answered, and... I tried to test him a little bit. I asked him, you know, how did you do it? Why did you do it? Are you Russian? Do you care about the election, right? Because if you hacked the Democratic Party, and you must care about the election. And he said, no, I don't care about the election. I don't care about Donald Trump. I don't care about Hillary Clinton. And then I asked him, are you Russian? He said, no, I'm not Russian. I hate Russia. I hate Vladimir Putin. And I said, okay, well then where are you from? And he said, I'm Romanian, just like the original Guccifer. I'm like, okay. And then I was like, okay, I'll ask him some questions in Romanian. I don't speak Romanian, but I went to Google Translate, and I just asked him like simple questions. And initially, he was a little bit annoyed at me, because he was like, is this a school test? Why are you asking me these questions in Romanian? But he answered in Romanian, and his answers seemed correct. You know, obviously, I don't speak Romanian, but using Google Translate, they made sense. But then I showed him later on, I showed them to a few Romanian speakers. One is a journalist that works with us. I have a couple of other sources that are Romanian just by chance. And I was like, does this make sense? Is this Romanian to you? And they were like, well, this is Romanian, but it's the Romanian that maybe a person that it's the second language or their third language. So this guy is definitely not Romanian of origin. And so this was yet another sign that he was lying. He was also like lying about how he hacked into the DNC. The technical details didn't make sense. So at that point, I just didn't believe him anymore. And at that point, actually, he had stopped talking to me because he was annoyed that I was asking him questions in Romanian. So he said, look, I'm busy, I have to go. And then he posted a blog post saying, if journalists want to ask me questions, send them to my Twitter, and then I'll collect the best ones and I'll answer later, which he never did, actually, or maybe answered a few, but the most boring ones, obviously. So at that point, nobody he stopped talking to people. I don't know if it's because whoever was behind that Twitter account got fired by the Russians for talking to me, or because they just realized there was no point in talking to journalists.
Yeah.
But yeah, that was the story. And Guccifer has been around. The other thing is that he's been around for weeks after that, releasing documents. But then magically, he disappeared after the day of the election. So the day before the election in the US, he said, I'm going to monitor the election. I'm going to be a volunteer monitoring the elections. And then he disappeared for weeks. He had another blog post saying, I'm back. And then, but he basically...
Yeah. But there was also another entity, which was DNC Leaks, right, at a certain point, which was apparently separated from Guccifer and...
This is an interesting, something that a lot of people have forgotten, because this website called DC Leaks actually comes out in March or April, so 3 months before the DNC hack. And no one really noticed it because they started publishing boring emails from generals. One of them was General Breedlove, a relatively famous general in like military circles in the US, but not someone, you know, not someone like Podesta or... And no one really noticed it. There was an article on The Intercept at the time. And I remember seeing that and I was like, what is this DC leak? But that didn't really work in the sense that they didn't get too much attention from their website. But months later, when the Podesta hack happens and other data comes out, researchers were able to connect all these characters together. So there was a clear link with public evidence between the DC leak website, Guccifer, the Podesta hack, and the DNC hack. So they were all connected together. So you could conclude that it was all part of the same operation from the same group.
Okay. So I think we can... come back also on this, because there are some other details that we can talk about. But I wanted to ask Stefania. So, you know, of course, WikiLeaks published thousands of emails from, you know, the DNC hack and also from Podesta. And some people, even people who were like, who have been sympathetic to WikiLeaks in the past, were a little bit perplexed by this, because they thought, you know, maybe WikiLeaks is kind of helping Trump over, you know, Clinton in this case. So there was this kind of debate. So I would ask you, so what do you think if WikiLeaks just did what have been always doing, so publishing leaks that things are relevant, or you know, there was a problem of timing of it, or you know, what do you think? And also, I know that not only you, as other people, you are a bit skeptical about the Russian attribution, or at least you think that, you know, it's too easy for now to say this. So maybe we can talk about this.
So. Yes, I have. First of all, I want to clarify. I'm not saying that Russian intelligence doesn't do this kind of operations. Of course, they do. I mean, that's what intelligence agencies do. They steal information which have intelligence values, and they use this information to do all sorts of operations. We can, like, for example, blackmail or taking advantage, some economical, political advantage of this kind of this information they steal. So I'm not naive to believe that they cannot do it. Of course, they can do it, and they do it. I'm absolutely aware they do it. So I'm not saying it's not true because the Russians cannot do it. they can do it. They do it, as many intelligence do. First, the U.S. intelligence, we have seen. I have worked on the Snowden files with Glenn Greenwald. I had access to the files, so I know what the NSA do. And with the NSA and other U.S. intelligence, even the CIA intelligence agency do. So I'm fully aware that this is the kind of things that intelligence do. My skepticism is about, first of all, about the many inconsistencies in the story. When you have complex stories, of course, you have many inconsistencies. That's quite normal, obvious. But in this case, here you have, according to the press report, I have read thousands of press reports. So you have the major inconsistencies. Let's take Gucci fair. So apparently here we have a very high-profile intelligence cyber espionage operation to target the U.S. democracy at the highest level. Because when you hack the presidential elections, you are hacking the U.S. democracy at the highest level. And you cannot run such operation without the highest approval. You need to have the highest approval to do this kind of operation. It's impossible that one day an FSB or a GRU operative decide to hack the Democratic National Committee and go ahead and do it. You need to have political approval at the highest level. So you have this very complex, very high-profile operation, cyber espionage operation, and then you have this stupid Guccifer 2.0 going around talking to reporters using Google Translate, which is completely mad, because when you use Google Translate, you expose yourself. You expose you are not a native speaker, and you expose your problems with language. Not only you have this stupid Guccifer, which basically posting online documents, Microsoft Word documents, were created by someone who called himself, let me check what his was, his Felix Ekmundovich. This was the name of the founder of the secret Soviet police. So, I mean, if you have created this online, fake online identity in order to have this obfuscation, kind of obfuscation on this high-profile cyber espionage, how can you have such a stupid obfuscation operation with such a stupid guy? I mean, it doesn't make sense. I really cannot understand how they can you can have this kind of inconsistency. And this is not the only one we have. Look at the DNC, for example. They spent six months, in order to start realizing the hacking. So you had the FBI notifying them in September 2015, but they didn't care for 6 months. This is completely mad. I mean, they can be, of course, appallingly incompetent. That's entirely possible, of course, but you know, it's quite incredible. You have the FBI even unwilling to go to the DNC headquarters to discuss this hacking, very high profile hacking, with the DNC executives. How is that? I mean, very bizarre. So even if you stick to the official version, there are so many inconsistencies that make you realize that something wrong with the official reconstruction. I'm not saying it's not true. I'm not saying, I'm just putting facts together. Journalists are supposed to do this, just putting facts together. And facts, we have seen, as we have read in all sorts of newspapers, are quite bizarre in the story. What happened with the publication? So, I mean, I can bring my experience. I mean, I'm there since 2009. I know WikiLeaks publishing methods and operations and choices since the beginning. I work with them on everything, on Afghan, before anyone could know WikiLeaks, I was already working with them. So I have seen all sorts of publishing, all sorts of choices. I'm not saying there is something, I'm not saying that WikiLeaks, all WikiLeaks did, I know about it. Well, it's possible, of course. I'm not the CIA, I'm not here during the night. I'm not saying it's impossible because I haven't seen it. I'm not saying this. I'm saying I bring my experience, 8 years experience working with them. I know how they work. And if you ask me, did you notice anything unusual during the publication of DNC email and during the publication of the Podesta email? Did you notice something wrong, something unusual, something they didn't have done before? I didn't. Absolutely, I didn't. They did whatever they have done in the past with all sorts of releases. They receive materials, they cross-check materials, they publish. When the material has the maximum impact, they publish. You can have the most incredible, you can have all sorts of impact, they publish. And this time, this is what I have witnessed. They did what they have done throughout their history. There's their 10 years of activities.
Yeah. Okay, thank you. Yeah, of course, none of us, I think, has the full picture of we are all absolutely trying to reconstruct a very complex puzzle. And but before going back also to the attribution aspect, because maybe we can go back on this, because I wanted to ask Andrei, you know, we talked about, you know, the states, agency, states do propaganda activities. Russia have been doing it for years, but not only Russia, also the US, other states. We know that, you know, there is also a Russian tradition from, you know, secret services of, you know, active measures and other kind of things. So maybe you could tell us something about this, and also if it's possible, if you think it's possible that on the cyber front, Russia recently started to become more aggressive, because I mean, as a journalist covering, for instance, security, I always know that, you know, there was a very high level activity of cyber espionage being done by Russia, right? So, but lately, if the attribution to Russia of some of these activities is correct, it seems that there is a more aggressive strategy, not just silent cyber espionage, but really hacking, strategic leaking, hacking for trolling sometimes. So do you think, yeah, how do you see this scenario, knowing Russia from the inside? And also, how do you see the reaction from US and European countries who seem to be now so worried about Russian influence? Is it maybe we are too much worried about it? Maybe it's a little bit hyped or spinned also by Western countries?
Thank you. First of all, Russia is not like China. It's absolutely different country. In China, you have hierarchy, you have generals, they give orders, someone gets hacked, and usually it helps in terms of attribution. In Russia, and I've been covering this issue since 1999, the picture is absolutely different. The biggest problem is that, yes, we have very powerful security and intelligence agencies, and they have cyber elements, very well funded, and very good mathematical schools, very good cryptographers, all that stuff. But when you look into the attacks, in many cases, actually in most cases, you can see that not these people we use it by the Kremlin. Instead, they use so-called informal actors, activists, people who might be not directly connected to the state, they might be not part of the government institutions, they might be not in uniforms. These people, they have some contracts. They're hired by the authorities, by the Kremlin, because it's extremely useful. It's actually, it's outsourcing. And this outsourcing as a tactics was adopted by the Kremlin, as I said, back in 99, maybe in 2000, first to attack the websites of Chechen rebels abroad. And it's extremely useful because it helps you to lower your risks and the cost of your operations. And of course, the Kremlin understands very clearly the benefits of these things, and they always maintain the same line, like, it's not about the government, it's about some people outraged by your actions. It's about some students, and actually the very first attack we got back in 1999, it was about real students from Tomsk. They attacked the website of Chechen rebels in Europe, and immediately the FSB encouraged them and issued a special statement saying, look, these guys, they are doing their patriotic duty. And we got all these attacks, and most visible of them started in 2007 with the attack on Estonia. Once again, we got not students, but activists of pro-Kremlin youth movement. And why we know that? And we know that for fact, because some of these people, they went on the record. And there was an interview in the Financial Times, and these people openly admitted they were behind this attack. And with DNC hack, we have actually the same picture. The very first comment made by Dmitry Peskov, who is a spokesperson of Vladimir Putin, was, we completely rule out that any government, I add with emphasis, any government organizations was behind this leak. So he made this special remark, it's not about government organizations, but he didn't say it's not about us. Once again, we try to use the same line. We have some people, well, they might be engaged in this kind of operation, but it's not about the government. The same line was repeated by Putin personally in September. He was interviewed by Bloomberg, and it was a very funny interview. It lasted 3 hours, and Putin was on his way to China, where he was to meet President Obama. So he was asked about hacking, and Putin enjoying himself, said, look, these hackers, they are so difficult to trace, they are so smart, it's absolutely impossible. And then it looks like he thought, well, maybe I need to be more cautious. And Bloomberg journalist already tried to move on to the next topic, but Putin stopped him and said, look, but first of all, we are not doing this on the federal level, which means the level of the government. So they tried to maintain this line from the beginning, and they still try to say that it's about some informal people who might be not directly connected to this. And I think it's this is a problem. These people, I mean informal people, and sometimes it's not about what we need to understand. It's not about criminal hackers. It's about companies. IT companies approached by the government, the Ministry of Communications, for example, and ask you to do something. And we have these examples, we have the facts, how the Russian companies, really good companies, for example, companies which provide the protection against DDoS attacks, and they're asked by the government to help to launch DDoS attacks on Ukraine, for example. We know that for fact. The problem with, of course, it's all about context. It's not about the investigation of this particular attack. But what's really interesting for us from the beginning is this connection with WikiLeaks, this element, because, to be honest, we in Russia and lots of journalists in Russia were always a bit confused by the activities of WikiLeaks regarding Russia. We do not understand many things. We do not understand why WikiLeaks, which is supposed to be against government, why, for some strange reasons, they decided to pick up to deal with Russia a guy who writes all his stuff in pro-Kremlin media. That really doesn't make sense. And his name is Israel Shamir, and he styled himself as a representative of WikiLeaks in Russia. For some strange reasons, he published all his stuff in Komsomolskaya Pravda. And Komsomolskaya Pravda is a very pro-Kremlin media, and it is actually it's famous for publishing leaks from FSB, from the Russian Secret Services. This guy, Israel Shamir, he was compromised long time ago when he gave up lots of stuff from cables to Belarusian officials, and that harmed a lot of people. Still, he maintained his access to WikiLeaks. Last year in 2016, he published a lot of stories promising new leaks about Hillary Clinton, which for me was a clear sign that he was still in contact with the team of WikiLeaks. Why that happened, we don't know. Another thing which happened started to me here in Perugia last year. There was a panel here, and Stefania was part of this panel, and Sarah Harrison, a chief of the investigative team of WikiLeaks, was also here. And it was a very strange moment, because Panama Papers was just published. It was at the beginning of April, and WikiLeaks responded with tweets attacking Panama Papers team. They said they questioned their credibility, their integrity, and finally they said these guys are funded by the US government. And that was really strange. And Putin personally, he picked up his argument, and when he had an interview, just a day before our panel here in Perugia, he said, "I know now that Panama Papers, it's a US government project because WikiLeaks said that." So I asked Sarah Harrison here, what's going on? I don't understand that. You are supposed to be all about leaks. And the principle promoted by Julian Assange from the very beginning was, if you believe that the information provided by a source is credible, you do not ask any questions about the sources. That was the principle. So why now you decided with Panama Papers, all of a sudden, start questioning the source? That was really strange, and she said something about that you can't hold me responsible for Putin's words, but she repeated the same line. She said, yes, I believe it's very strange that Panama Papers attacked, firstly, Vladimir Putin. And I can address the same question to WikiLeaks now. So why on earth, if you have all these leaks, why you decided to attack Hillary Clinton?
Yeah, maybe... Stefania, do you want to say something?
Yes, yeah. Yes, because this story of Israel Shamir goes back to the 2010. I mean, I never see Israel Shamir around in 8 years, never experienced anything strange with Israel Shamir. I think this goes back to the very beginning of WikiLeaks.
Oh, no. He's publishing his stuff now.
Now?
As I said, in 2016, he published lots of articles in Komsomolskaya Pravda, publishing some information from WikiLeaks and promising new leaks from WikiLeaks.
Well,
saying specifically about what's going on.
Well, okay, but do you have any certainty that he has advanced access to this document? Because, you know, you can run an article just based on cutting and pasting information. Do you can you say that basically he has advanced access to these original documents? Because that's the issue. We have seen all sorts of people saying, oh, WikiLeaks is saying this. According to WikiLeaks documents, now, I mean, every time when I ask directly, could you please point me to the original documents you access to write this document? And they are unable to show which kind of documents did they access. I mean, that's why I'm wondering whether Israel Shamir has any access to original documents from the WikiLeaks. I never heard the story. I mean, I know that the story goes back to the 2010, and in the last 8 years, I never heard that Israel Shamir had any access, any partnership, anything with WikiLeaks.
I can say only repeat my line, that he promised in his stories that
more
leaks,
Andrei,
about Hillary Clinton to come, and she specifically said what these leaks would be about. So I think it's something quite accurate.
You know, Andrei, I can claim whatever, but the issue is whether he has advanced access to original documents. That's the real point, because that's the access to the WikiLeaks. That's the partnership, when you have advanced access to the documents. I can claim whatever. I can claim I work with Snowden, I work with... But if I don't have exclusive advanced access, well, that's different.
Maybe to go on the Shamir story itself, that I don't know how much we should stick to it. Maybe I would like to ask, do you think that there is a problem of perception in this moment of WikiLeaks being perceived too close to Russia?
Yeah, there is a problem of perception, because we see that basically this campaign against this disinformation campaign against WikiLeaks is working, and this campaign will bring very serious consequences for WikiLeaks, because since 2010 the US wanted to use the Espionage Act, which means 30 years in prison or even life sentence in prison, which is very serious, and they will do it. With this Russian conspiracy, they will do it. They will use the Espionage Act, I'm sure. I'm absolutely sure they will use this story for applying for using the Espionage Act, as they did with Chelsea Manning, as they did with Edward Snowden, as they did with Thomas Drake, as they did with John Kiriakou. All these people have been persecuted using the Espionage Act. So I'm sure they will do it. And I'm honestly shocked to see. I mean, it was really tragic, in my opinion, to see thousands of journalists reporting as factual evidence something which is not factual evidence. Because if you take the 17 intelligence agency assessment, that's an assessment. Where are the evidence?
Maybe we
what
can
kind
talk
of
about
evidence?
This.
We journalists are not supposed to publish, you know, assessment. We are supposed to demand evidence. That's why I think highly of Glenn Greenwald. He was the only one in the U.S. saying we have to demand evidence, because where's the evidence?
Okay, so maybe we can talk about the evidence of, you know. So let's go back to the U.S. Okay, and to the U.S. Russia hacking leaking story, because I mean, of course, there has been something that, you know, the U.S. government attribution to Russia has been very strong. I mean, the way, the claim has been very strong in a new way. And also there has been some analysis, some reports about it, you know, that attribution is a tough thing to do, okay? We know that. But we know that there are some methods, some way to do it. Based on analysis of basically digital artifacts and digital traces and infrastructure, right? So there are security experts and companies doing this kind of work, which is difficult, but, you know, there is a methodology in a way. So let's go back to this. Lorenzo, what do you think about this? Is the attribution and the evidence showed by the U.S. government enough, or at least is there a consensus among the security researchers that there are, I don't know, enough evidence, or maybe not enough, but many circumstantial evidence? Maybe you can explain us.
Yeah, I'll try to be short, because we only have 10 minutes. But
yeah.
I mean, there's two different things here. So the U.S. government came out with the accusation, which is obviously very grave, and I agree. Like, I would like to see more evidence. I would like to see where they based this assessment on. But we also have to remember, and I'm not justifying it, but intelligence agencies don't want to tell you their secrets. You know, I don't know if this is the case, but if they have like a phone interception of, like, you know, Vladimir Putin or someone else admitting this, they're not going to release it to the public. I wish they did, but they're not going to do it. But this is one thing, and this comes in October, way later. Like, before October, in the months leading up to it, there's a lot of public evidence coming, not just from American companies, but all kinds of security companies from Europe, independent academic researchers, people that have followed these hacking groups for a decade, saying this is the same group. And that's, like, I think at this point, you know, I'm not a security researcher, but there's a 99% consensus in the security community that the people behind the DNC hack and everything else was these two groups, Fancy Bear and Cozy Bear, which are just code names, kind of stupid names, by the way. But anyway, if you forget about the stupid nicknames, these are groups that have been known to many companies for years. And this means that they, what does this mean? These companies, this means that these companies have been followed their operations for years. This means that like they saw actual attacks against their clients and customers, and they were able to trace them back to this group, because all groups have some sort of like signature. They leave behind traces. Their techniques over time, they tend to repeat themselves because they're humans. They're just like us, right? I have a certain style of writing. They have a certain style of hacking. And even though you can, in theory, fake it and you can pretend to be someone else, over time you just can't, and eventually you expose yourself. Now, does this mean that this group is, like Andrei said, like do they have a uniform? Do they go, you know, to the Red Square and the Kremlin? Do they check in and work in the office from 9 to 5? That's one step forward that we cannot say, but their targets are all interesting political targets for Russia. These are not like kids that want to make some money putting ransomware or stealing bank data. These are people that like attack Russian journalists, they attack Ukrainian activists, they attack diplomats. These are spies. They might not be this might not be their full-time job, but they're spies, and this is public evidence. And it goes back to like 2014, 2012. Like even at that point, like there was a report by Google that they didn't spell it out, but they said APT28, sorry, now the code name, but Fancy Bear is part of the GRU. Like, I mean, they might be wrong, you know, it's impossible, but this is like a consensus now. And saying that we haven't seen evidence is just not true. We have seen a lot of evidence already, more than almost in any other attack, actually.
Yeah, maybe we could go on. At the end, we can't really define in this panel who has done it. But maybe we could wonder a little bit about the consequences for journalism of this new scenario. If we are entering, and this is a question for all because we don't have much time, and maybe we can ask also for questions. But if we are entering an era of strategic hacking and leaking that may be done sometimes by state-sponsored actors, right? So is there the risk that WikiLeaks or the media or the journalists, all of us, could be used in one way or another from one entity or another in order to push an agenda or, you know, like... and so how journalists should behave in front of this scenario?
I think we are in a very dangerous situation. There was always a big definition between a big line between, say, the Western approach to cybersecurity and Russian approach. And the Russians always wanted to talk about so-called information warfare or information security. And the Americans and Western Europeans were always wanted to talk about cybersecurity. What's the difference? The Russians wanted to talk about the content. That was from the very beginning, from the 2000, when we got the very first doctrine of information security. What does it mean? That the Russian generals, cyber generals, wanted to patrol the internet and to try to identify, given the content, and they tried to identify the content and then to judge who these guys and these media were working for, CIA or for some Western hostile forces, etc. And I think it's a really big problem that all of a sudden, thanks to 2016 and DNC hack, we all sort of started talking this Russian language. We're all now talking about information aggression, information warfare. We are talking about the content. And I think it might be extremely dangerous. We already had an example when the Washington Post published a very strange article, some findings of a very marquee group, which listed websites critical of the administration of the president, and they said, look, these guys might be puppets of the Kremlin. I think it's a very Russian approach in a way. And I think we need to be very aware of this danger, and maybe we need to remember that the most important thing is not where you got your information, is the way how you check this information, how you write your story.
Okay, Stefania, do you want to say something also about what the journalists, I mean, anyway, we don't know, we will, maybe we will never know for sure, for us, 100%, so how we should do as journalists?
Yes, so first of all, I want to, I disagree with Lorenzo that we have enough the evidence. If you consider that the FBI was even unable, to this day, unable to access DNC servers, this is widely reported. So the FBI basically was forced to rely on third-party information, which means CrowdStrike assessment. CrowdStrike is the cybersecurity firm enrolled by the DNC. So how can you manage an independent investigation when you didn't have access to these servers? I think it's very, this is a very serious issue. I mean, CrowdStrike was paid by the DNC to do this investigation on the servers. And the FBI cannot access the DNC servers. This is a real problem. And I'm shocked by how the press has behaved. I'm really shocked because I have seen Iraq. I have seen Iraq war. I know, I mean, I think the media, US media, have tons of blood in their hands because of what they did with the Iraq war. And I hope not to see again what happened with the Iraq war, but we are seeing this again. They are just repeating whatever the intelligence agency is saying, and they are running stories based on intelligence assessment, intelligence confidence. These people never bring evidence. They don't ask for it. I understand that the intelligence, as Lorenzo said, may not provide evidence of interception of the Russian government at the highest level. I understand this, but we journalists must remain skeptic, must say, well, I understand you cannot give me evidence, you cannot provide the evidence, you cannot make this evidence public, but I cannot believe you, because that's not what a journalist is supposed to do. He's not supposed to believe anyone, you know? So I think the press coverage was a real shame, complete shame. I completely disagree with the press reports on this case. What about leaks? What about working on leaks? I mean, I think it is a complex issue, of course. You have this problem of being used as a tool, not only with leaks. We journalists are always exposed to this risk of being used by one actor or another. From this point of view, I don't see a big difference. I mean, I think it's quite usual, and it is important that we don't do this. We don't become the useful idiot for this or the other party. I mean, it's really important, but it's up to us, to our professionalism, to our ethics.
Sure.
You know?
Sure.
We have a question.
Any question? Yes.
Stefania was saying it's up to us, for sure. But point is that working on.
Okay. No? Microphone? I was saying that I totally agree with you, it's up to us not be used. But when we talk about leaks, WikiLeaks is our first source, because we are not you. So you cooperate with them since 2009. We have to wait for your work and for them to put the documents online. So my question for you is, do WikiLeaks vet their source, or better, do WikiLeaks ask itself if the source has an agenda? Because I was in the United States in the last 7 years, and during this campaign, this presidential campaign, it has been really frustrating. I felt like a puppy, because of course the DNC leaks, the Podesta leaks, was so important, you have to report about this, of course. But then it was like, yeah, very good, nothing about Trump. Okay, nothing about Trump, but it's something frustrating. So do they ask the source, do they ask themselves if the source has an agenda? How can be sure that we are not playing for Assange or whoever?
Thank you. Should they? Okay. So, first of all, very important thing, you have not to believe me. You don't believe anyone. Don't believe anything. Yeah.
I am asking you just because.
Yeah, but in any case, don't believe anyone. You when it comes to WikiLeaks, they publish everything. They publish documents, original documents. Everyone can access documents, check them, and see whether the journalist says...
But it is not the question.
Okay, I know. Let me come to your question. Why not about Mr. Trump? Well...
Yeah. Is this source has this source an agenda?
Okay. So
that's the point.
Yeah.
Are you playing for them or not?
So first of all, you have to realize that WikiLeaks has a submission system to send material, secret documents and material sources want to send. So in many cases, WikiLeaks has no idea about its sources. They don't know the source identity. So, I mean, it's quite difficult to understand the motivation, the
so it's not an issue for Assange.
No, no. I mean, they don't...
The
wait. I'm not saying this. I'm not saying they are not questioning what the source is doing. They don't know. Often they don't know. They have no idea about the identity of the source because this submission system is completely anonymous, and we know that it is anonymous because during the Manning trial, it was proved that basically this system provided protection to Manning. So we know this. But when you receive documents, so let's have this situation. WikiLeaks receive thousands of DNC documents. They check, because they do check documents. I can tell you they seriously check documents. And we check documents. We partner do parallel checks because we don't trust anyone.
Sorry.
So
maybe we can continue.
Yeah, yeah. They check. But okay. But what should they done? Not publishing information in the public interest?
Maybe we can go on. Thank you for being
here. Much.
Maybe we can go on.
Yeah, maybe we can meet outside if you want to continue talking.